Welcome to the Archaeoastronomy Database. In the Boyne Valley of Ireland, below the famous monument of Newgrange, new prehistoric features have been discovered along the banks of the Boyne River when dry conditions caused markings in crops to be visible using drone photography. One of the most famous of these was discovered by Anthony Murphy and Ken Williams and has become known as Dronehenge, also known as the Geometric Henge. Two nearby features have become known as Hidden Henge and the Univalent Henge. Now if we take a closer look, we can also have a clearer outline of Dronehenge. And you can see the features here a little bit more clearly. And one of the distinguishing features of Dronehenge is this structure on the west side, somewhat north of west. Now Dronehenge is by far the more complicated feature, and you can see that there is an inner ring that's just slightly off the circle. Of kind of these paired features. And then there's another concentric ring somewhat following this path, and then another beyond that. Interestingly, none of them stay exactly on the concentric circle, but rather deviate at certain points. It's possible even that this was intended to be a spiral, starting at the inner edge and working its way around until it starts to deviate from the perfect circle, and then joining up with the next section and coming around and then deviating again out from the main circle to the outermost circle. It's also interesting to note that a circle that intersects the center of Dronehenge follows along with these features that don't match the concentric pattern of Dronehenge. You can see a pair of features here, 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 and here, and then there's some distortion, and finally another paired feature here. And so this may have been an earlier monument that was later replaced. Now, if we were to take this axis towards the feature on the west side, we would come up with an azimuth of about 285.2 degrees. Of course, there could be some variability in that, and just working from the placement and imagery that I have, and any distortions that may come through with that. But using what is available, that's a good measurement to start with. And you can see that this axis centers where I've started this spiral. And if you count the features of the inner circle, there's 1 to 17. Before this central feature, and on the other side, although they're a little bit distorted, you can see also 1 to 17 features, making this the central feature working outward from this feature on the left. It also goes through these two features just outside of what could be termed an entrance. Sometimes it's been nicknamed a ticket booth. And this azimuth corresponds to a central declination of 9.27 degrees. Now with the sun, that would be the center of the sun, but it could be aiming for the sun at a slightly different position, with the full orb of the sun sitting on the horizon, or with just the last light of the sun shining through at that azimuth. So there could be a little bit of range in the declination value there. But in general, that declination value corresponds to the position of the sun in the Neolithic, and this would be about the same throughout the Neolithic and into even the early Bronze Age, with just a little bit of variation, but corresponding to a day about 22 or 23 days northward of the equinox position. So that would be 22 or 23 days after spring equinox, or 22 or 23 days prior to the autumn equinox. So if we go into stellarium, we can see that in the Neolithic, and I've set the date to a little bit later in the Neolithic, although we don't know exactly when these features would have been constructed, but as Henge features, they would be around 3000 BC. And we can see that on this date, with the sun at declination 9.48, that it would be setting on this azimuth of 285.2, with the full orb of the sun visible. And if I advance time, we have a position very close to the equinox. The next day would be just south of the equinox, and the previous just north of the equinox. And because of the uneven number of days between summer and winter solstice, due to orbital parameters at this time, usually dividing the year in half between solstices would give you a position slightly north of the equinox position as the midpoint of the year, which was more likely the target of dividing the time that way than our modern concept of equinox being exactly zero declination. And so again, if I go back those 23 days, we have the sun at that position. And it's moving fairly rapidly around that time, but one day earlier, and you might get a last gleam. One day later than that, we'd be a little bit higher than the horizon for that target. And most of the time, when dividing the year into 16 parts, you would end up with something around 9.4 or 9.2. And there is some variation from year to year because of the fractional day of the year, which we adjust for with leap years. So you can see here, on this date, the sun might move from just showing to most of it being above the horizon. And there would be that variability, which would have to be adjusted for by adding a leap day approximately every 4 years. And these markers near the equinox, or the one just north of the equinox itself, would probably be the best markers for adding that leap date, as the sun is moving fairly rapidly at these times. So once you've set up the rough count, you'd be able to watch for when the regular count wasn't quite enough to get it to the correct position, and then add an extra day that year, and then continue the count from there. Now, also at this declination, it's possible that around the year 2785 BC, or just prior to that for a short period of time, the bright star Altair in Aquila, the eagle, was seen setting. So it's a possible target. And even less likely, the supernova that produced the jellyfish nebula was setting at that position around 2880 BC. Now, the dates that astronomers give for the supernova that produced that nebula ranges from anywhere from 30,000 to 3,000 years ago. So that's quite a span of time. In astronomical terms, it's actually quite focused, but for actually determining whether that was ever the time, like if 2880 BC ended up being the exact time when the supernova occurred, there would probably be very little way to narrow it down that much. But it would be interesting to think about the fact that if a bright supernova ever occurred during the Neolithic, a time when people were interested in observing phenomena in the sky, that it would be, at the very least, a very notable event. And the supernova that produced that nebula is estimated to be extremely bright, high magnitude, probably -6, -7, which means it would have been visible for a time, even during the day. So that would be quite remarkable. Just something to think about. But I think that the 16th of a year north of the equinox position is more likely. And in fact, from the center of Dronehenge through the center of the Hidden Henge, you have another alignment to 1/16th of a year south of the equinox position. So the equinox would occur between those two positions, and these would mark either a 16th of a year before or after the spring or fall equinoxes. If the line were continued, it would almost go through the center of the other henge. Now, also along this southern line, in about 3200 BC, the bright star Betelgeuse in Orion would have been visible setting as well. So that's another possible target. But with both of them connecting to that 16th position, north and south of the equinox, I think that's the most likely alignment, and at least the observations made for those declinations. So again, for the northern, the declination is closer to somewhere around 9.2, 9.3, 9.4, with that little bit of variation in how the sun sits on the horizon. And for the southern declination, around negative 8.47 would be a rough number to aim for. I also looked at the possibility of some other angles. Depending on how the above ground features were laid out, light could have been allowed in at more oblique angles, reaching to different points along the perimeter of the henge. This pink line represents the northern cross quarter position. Also, from the position of Dronehenge, along this line, looking out between the features, I observed that this would be the rising position of Deneb, the bright star in Cygnus the Swan, which held roughly the same declination throughout the entirety of the Neolithic period and a little bit beyond. And this actually would have aligned with the very edge of Newgrange as defined by its curbstones. Similarly, a feature in this henge has an azimuth that points to the rising position of Deneb as well. In this case, it's lower on the slope that Newgrange sits on, just where it starts to flatten out. From the Hidden Henge through roughly the center of the Univalate Henge, the maximum northern moon could be observed setting. And from the Hidden Henge the summer solstice sunrise could have been observed coming just out of the edge of Douth in the distance. So it's possible that some of these sight lines were set up at certain times for various purposes and then later expanded or replaced or obstructed as different uses were adopted and changes were made over time. So that's just a quick overview of some of the possible alignments between these henges down by the banks of the River Boyne. And it's really just scratching the surface of some of the new features that have been discovered. As you can see, there's a lot more going on in the area that could be talked about in the future. So much to do, so we'll just keep working away at it. I hope you enjoyed this video. I appreciate your enthusiasm and support. Thank you especially to those who have donated on PayPal and Patreon. That really helps me to be able to continue with the work. Please like and subscribe, and if you're able to donate, the links are in the description, and there are also links to Facebook page for discussion, to the website, and please take a look in those areas as well and get involved in any way that you can. Thank you, and until next time, keep watching the skies.